you anyway, because you love me.
Hi, Corpus Christi. Welcome to another Better Way Ministry Bible study. And those of you online, welcome to you as well. Today's Bible study, Christ and Messiah, they both mean Savior. Savior. But what, saved from what? Well, there's only good news in this answer. There's only good news in the gospel, which means good news of Christ. Saved from what? Are you experiencing issues in your life that you wish God would come down and take care of today? You know, the Savior has come. The good news to the earth. God already split the skies. And he told the shepherds, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Do you have peace today? You know, the Bible says in Isaiah 32 that the work of righteousness is peace. Jesus said in John 14, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. My peace I leave with you. Jesus wants to give you peace in your life. And if you don't have peace, there could be a multitude of reasons why. But if Jesus is giving peace, why didn't you receive it? That is the question that you want to ask yourself. Because there's nothing in this life that's so big it can destroy your peace. When King David, when he looked at his giant, he didn't see him. He didn't proclaim him with his mouth to be a giant. He said, he just called him this uncircumcised Philistine. He's going to be, I'm going to feed you to the fowls of the air this day. Because you have not defied Israel. You've defied the God of the armies of Israel. So whenever you are experiencing anything in your life, magnify the Lord and don't give the devil any more credit, because the Savior, he's come to save you from the issues that you're experiencing right now that you want to be saved from. Destructive habits, patterns in your life. Do you just wring your hands and not know what to do? Good news. The Christ, the Savior, he's already been given unto the world. Every word of God is pure, and he is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. Let's pray. Father, we just love you. We thank you for this pure word. I pray, Father, for every soul that listens, that they would see the Christ and Messiah and their Savior, that whatever it is that they need saved from, he is their Savior. And so, Father, we just love you, and we thank you that you are so good to us in giving thine only begotten Son, the Lord's Christ, unto us. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to use a few Old Testament scriptures to see. These are our in-samples. They are our examples, according to 1 Corinthians 10. So we use them as our examples. As opposed to, hey, I was walking in the grocery store the other day, and I don't want to limit the Word of God. When I give you only the pure Word, it will fit every ear out there. If I take and I go from the Word of God over to a situation that I'm thinking of, it's no longer pure. This is pure. I want you to know that these words are spirit. and they are life. And they can speak life into the situation that you need help from the destruction. Let God speak life through this word into your situation. I don't care what it is. God has your answer. He'll bring you peace while you wait. It came to pass in the days of Ahaz, son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, the king of Judah, that Rezin, the king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, went up toward Jerusalem to war against it, but could not prevail against it. So we see here that Judah is being attacked by multiple fronts. First of all, by its sister Israel and the king of Syria. But they couldn't prevail against Judah. And it was told the house of David, that's Judah, saying, Syria is confederate with Ephraim. So Syria and Israel, they're getting together. And his heart was moved, and the heart of the people, as the trees of the wood are moved with the wind. They received a report, and they allowed their heart to be moved with the report that bad was coming. And their heart was moved. Moved from where to where? Moved from their reliance upon God over into the area of fear. Their heart was moved. If we're not careful, our hearts will be moved. When a doctor knocks on your door and he gives you what he sees, and he gives you the report about what he sees, what is your response? Is your heart moved away from God? And oh, what do I do? Do you ask God, what do I do? Do you ask the doctor, what do I do? What's your first response? His heart was moved. Their heart was moved. Then said the Lord unto Isaiah, go forth now to meet Ahaz, thou and Shearjashub, thy son, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool of the highway of the fuller's field, and say unto him, take heed and be quiet. Fear not. Take heed. Be quiet. Stop speaking against the words of faith. Stop saying words that are not faith. Neither be faint-hearted. So now he gets around to his heart. First, shut your mouth. Stop speaking words that are not faith. Your words will be written in the heavens. God is waiting for the word of faith to come out of your mouth so he can act. And he will act on your behalf. You know, there was a guy, he came, he brought his son, and he couldn't do anything about it, about his sickness. So he brought him to the disciples. The disciples couldn't do anything about it. So they brought him to Jesus and said, hey, I brought him to your disciples, they couldn't do anything about it. Jesus looked at him and he goes, do you believe I can do that? And he said, Lord, I believe. This man, what he said, the most profound answer to Christ that I've seen in the Bible. He said, yes, I believe. Lord, called him Lord, help thou mine unbelief. That is absolutely perfect. That is where each one of us sit. Whenever we get these things, we say, yes, I believe. And if there's anything in there that's not belief, help me. He's there. He'll do it. Good news. Take heed, be quiet, fear not, neither be faint-hearted, for the two tails of these smoke and firebrands, for the fierce anger of Rezin with Syria and of the son of Remaliah. Because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah have taken evil counsel against thee, saying, let's go up against Judah and vex it, and let us make a breach therein for us, and set a king in the midst of it, even the son, they got it all figured out, the son of Tabeel. So they're going to go up there. They're going to rip the king off his place. They're going to they're going to put their own king, and they're going to take control of Judah. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall not stand, neither shall it come to pass. For the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin, and within 65 years, 65 years shall Ephraim be broken, that it be not a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria. Remember, Jesus said, I must needs go through Samaria. Remember that? And the head of Samaria is Remaliah's son. If you will not believe, here it is, if you will not believe, surely you will not be established. You know, maybe your children are out and they're not doing right. Maybe your spouse is out and they're not doing right. Maybe finances are just not where they're supposed to be. Maybe it's a legal issue. Maybe it's, I don't care the issue. Maybe it's just drama within the family issue. Somebody's familiar spirit is just tearing through the whole family. If you will not believe, surely you shall not be established. Don't let the report sway the heart as these people did. The first thing he tells the prophets, go down there and tell them to be quiet. Why? We have power in our mouth. We give an account for every idle word. We're brought into judgment for what we have done, but we given an account of every idle word. Because we are made in the image of God, we're living souls. And if you have been baptized, if you've repented and been baptized in Jesus' name, then you receive the Holy Ghost. If you did not receive the Holy Ghost, did you actually repent? Are you different? Jesus said, when you believe, as Scripture hath said, in this believe day and age, you look across denominations and every one of them seemingly will have a different interpretation of calling on the Lord. They've made calling on the Lord a recital. They've made believing just, can you read? And but Jesus said in John 7:38, when you believe as Scripture has said, out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. You must be born again. That doesn't happen to the lost. It happens to those who have been converted. So, once you're converted and you have the Holy Ghost, magnify the Lord. The Holy Ghost power. Jesus said you're going to get power when you get the Holy Ghost. That's why he died. That's why he preached the kingdom of God. No one was entering into the kingdom of God. The kingdom of Israel. That's why they came to Jesus after he came back and he said, are you going to return the kingdom to Israel now? They were under a Roman occupation. He goes, look, my father's got that under his power. But that's not your concern. The kingdom of God is within you. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Who's righteous? The Christ's. The Savior's. Unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which shall be to all people. And it is now to all people. Israel rejected him and killed him. They planted him into the ground, and he is the first fruits that was raised from the dead. And he has all power and authority before he died. Now that he did die and he was raised, he now has a glorified body to go with all power and authority. He is Lord. He is the potentate of the world, not earth, of the world. When the devil came and wanted to give him the power and the glory of these few little kingdoms on this little tiny globe, shortcut, Jesus said, no. I'm going to worship my Father only. And sent the devil, took away his power and dominion, he did it with the Holy Ghost power at his baptism, and then set men free and said, okay, enter the kingdom of God. That's wherever Paul went in like Acts 19, wherever he showed up, he said, did you get the Holy Ghost? 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 Why not? What were you baptized unto? The only thing that's going to conquer your will is Holy Ghost power. He is the one that's going to come. He's going to stand up. The Spirit of the Lord will lift up the standard against the enemy when he comes in like a flood, but the Holy Ghost is going to give you power over your own will and power over all the power of the devil. But it comes from your submission unto the Christ. That power works when we are weak. It is not our power, it is His power. It's the Holy Ghost within us. If you will not believe, surely you will not be established. But these scriptures are awesome, and you can believe. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and the lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And it was so that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. We just got included. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. When this news got back to town and the people figured out that the Christ was born, well, they all had imaginations about what he was going to do, about how he was going to come about. And they had an expectation, but not according to Scripture. As we read later on, whenever the Savior, the Christ, Christ the Lord, when he came in and he sat down and he tells them, let me back up, from this time, they made a seat in the synagogue for the Christ. It may have been there beforehand, but at this good news, I know they made it. If they didn't have one, they made one then. And there was an empty seat that was reserved in every synagogue that was reserved for the Christ, the Lord, to show his coming, to show they believed he was coming. So whenever he comes, on the day after he comes out of the wilderness, he just whipped Satan, took away the dominion that Adam had given unto him, and he comes in and he goes, I've been anointed to preach the gospel, to heal the brokenhearted, to preach the gospel to the poor, and Luke 4:18, Isaiah 61, verse 1, and halfway down, and then he stops. He preached the acceptable year of the Lord. In other words, and he said unto those people in the synagogue, when he opened that up, he read Isaiah 61, and he sat down, and he said, and he looked at the people, and he goes, this day, that scripture is fulfilled in your ears. In other words, without saying, I'm the Christ, he said, I'm the Christ. That scripture was fulfilled, and I'm sitting in the seat. They all looked at him and they all wondered. They remembered his sisters and his brothers and his family. And they're looking and they're thinking, we know you. We watched you grow up. Have you forgotten that? And so they're troubled. As I'm just glad I live when I live now. I'm sure I would have missed it. I'm pretty sure I would have missed the Christ. I would like to think that I would have said, hey, were you born of a virgin? Or go up to his mom and say, hey, were you a virgin when you had him? Nobody's asking. Hey, have you got the seven spirits of God? Hey. Nobody's asking those questions. They're all just wondering. And then they want to argue with them. Well, an hour or so after, maybe not even that long, after he sits down, he tells them, hey, I'm the Christ and I'm here, and he truly was. They take him out to shove him off a cliff. And that is why he opened the good news, which shall be to all people. So dinner was opened from the Father to eat the bread of life unto the whole world. Because he went to his own, but his own received him not. But this is good tidings of great joy. Now that joy was diminished 2 years later whenever Herod sent to Bethlehem and they're grabbing every child of 2 years and under and they're slamming their head into a stone wall. Bam! And killed them all. Joseph takes off and he goes to Egypt. So this tale of great joy became folklore, so to speak. So by the time the Christ comes, where was the great joy? It was more of a wonderment. It was folklore that just never materialized. We're still hoping. He's still coming. But they got under Roman occupation, or they were still under Roman occupation, and it just didn't match up with their expectations whenever God fulfilled the promise of so long. Truly, in our age, we are in the end times. We are watching the Christian population of Iraq has been reduced by 82% just recently, within the last few years of our sitting president. The Christian population in Syria has been reduced 66%. They're being sought out and slaughtered wholesale. We are in the end times. And it is high time to be about the kingdom of God. If you're going to do anything for Christ, if you're going to believe, if you're going to set your feet and believe for whatever it is that you're in belief for, trust me, this good news is still out there. Wisdom proclaims its voice every day. Proverbs 9. Every day I cry unto you, O sons of men, in the place of concourse. Right in the middle of the city. Right in the middle where everything is happening. Wisdom cries out. Great joy. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with an angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. They're under a Roman occupation. the guy that's directly in charge gets so fired up that the king of Israel has been born that he goes down and he kills every child 2 years and under. See, God knows what takes place after death. God knows what takes place with you whenever you're being killed because of the sake, for the sake of his son. When the disciples were beaten, he said, "Rejoice. Ha! Great is your reward in heaven for you, the reproach that you take for the Christ." It's the opposite of the world. We don't have to be here in the end days wringing our hands, worrying. Not with Holy Ghost power. I am glad I'm not in those countries, but I pray for those that are. And I pray for Israel. And I do what I can for those who have power and authority to cause these people to stop that kind of slaughter. But this is the end days. It's not like people think we're in them. It's coming. And it's going to be a time on the earth when God's going to deal with every living soul who has walked in his own way. The sin problem, Christ took care of the sin. We're all wrong. We're just not all wrong in the same spot. He's not coming to justify the sin. Jesus already took care of that. He's coming because of your own way. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. He that knew no sin became sin that we might become the righteousness of God in him. The sin deal's over with. Now just deal with your own will. When Christ was in the Garden of Eden, Gethsemane, and he knew they were coming to take him, and he knew the time was imminent for him to be on the cross, and they came to him and they said, "Hey, we're seeking," and he says, "Who do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he goes, "I am." And they all fell down backwards. A little power of the Christ. Come out. The Father's like, "I'm with you, son." So he sees this, he despises the cross, he despises what he is about to go through, but he does it for the love of his Father. Are you going to love Jesus at his appearing? Or be ashamed at his coming? If you repent your own way and you get Holy Ghost power, he'll give you power to do that which is right. And in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God unto a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came into her and said, "Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women." And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, casting in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. Look what a conflict this ends up being for Mary. She's not married, and she's going to end up with child. She's highly favored of the Lord. Blessed art thou among women. And yet she is going to get a bad rap coming against her. And it's going to start with Joseph. And the angel said, because she's found with child while engaged, so to speak, to him. They're betrothed. They're engaged. And so they were in that year's period there that the Jews had, that from the engagement time, a year later, you were going to be married. And during that year's time, if you shouldn't come out with a child because you're not supposed to be with anybody during that time. You're supposed to be a virgin. You both are. And so here she is being told, "Fear not, for thou hast found favor with God. Behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb and shall bring forth a son, and you're going to call his name Jesus. And he shall be great. He shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever in his kingdom. There shall be no end. Then said Mary unto the angel, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? She didn't say words of not faith, unfaith. She didn't have that. She just said, how's this going to be? And so he tells her. And the angel said unto her, the Holy Ghost is going to come upon you, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing. What do you call a child who that is the seed, which is the word from the Holy Ghost in a woman's womb? You call it a holy thing. Why are we called new creatures? In Christ, you're a new creature. And if you're not, you're not in Christ. In Christ, we're new creatures. Why? Because God didn't assign a name other than he called us a new creature. Because we are now dead to sin, and we are the tabernacle of the Holy Ghost, and yet our soul resides in a vile body that cannot be redeemed, but shall be changed. And so we're new creatures. Awesome, isn't it? It's awesome. For with God nothing shall be impossible. And Mary said, behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word. And the angel departed from her. Wow. That sweet woman. I mean, a lot of people are going to enjoy meeting her. But I look to Mary. She just got the greatest assignment. You are a virgin and you've been highly favored by God and chosen by God. You're going to bear the Christ of the world. The one that was prophesied before the foundation of the earth. The one that's going to be here long after this age and many ages to come without end. And you are going to bear him. And her words were, be it unto me according to thy word. There's no lack of faith in that woman. You talk about a strong woman of God. I hear those adjectives and I see people that they're directed at. Let me tell you what. Are you a woman? Do you want to know the strongest woman that ever was? This woman held herself. She purposed that all of her was for her husband in the Christ. As only as God would allow. I mean, for us, it's the Christ. For if you're within the sound of my voice, as Christ directs. She stayed the course. She was holy. She was favored by God because she had a relationship with him. King David was a man after God's own heart. And he ended up having the wisest son that ever lived, that was ever born, other than the Christ. And so Mary, she holds herself, and then an angel appears to her. And he says, woman, you are highly favored. She goes, well, all right. This is good. Talk to me. How's that going to be? That is a woman of faith. That is a strong woman. That she sees the word of God and will not vary. You want to be a strong woman of God? Be a woman of virtue. Go and read Proverbs 31. you want to be a strong woman with virtue. Be that kind of strong. Not strong-willed. Strong in faith. Strong, so strong that you're so weak, you're the mother of the Christ. And highly favored by God. That sweet woman, be it unto me according to thy word. I wish that is the only thing that was in my record book. And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. If you will not believe, surely you will not be established. Now we're back to Ahaz. Mary believed. Joseph believed. Joseph, being a just man, sought to put Mary away privily. He was privately going to put her away. Yet what did the law say? Think with me for a minute about the judgment of God, that God is after us knowing his judgments. Think with us for a moment. The law said she's to be stoned with the elders. When they got the woman, they caught her in the very act of adultery, and they bring her over there. They say, look, Jesus, this is what Moses said. What do you say? Well, he didn't condemn her. So here we are. Here the mother of the Christ is found with child. Obviously, she's been with somebody. And nobody believes it's the Holy Ghost except one man. The only one that mattered. Joseph. But look at how God described him. Before he knew it was the Holy Ghost. The Bible, the Holy Ghost himself who wrote this, King James, said of Joseph. But Joseph, being a just man, was going to break the law and put her away privately where no one could know. And God, who gave Moses the law and the commandments, talks about Joseph, who did not obey that law, as he's just. And he was going to be the man that God was going to allow the Christ to grow up in and observe. How men are. You know, the judgment of God is the letter of the law killeth, the spirit giveth life. God is so good to us. If you will not believe, surely you will not be established. But there's good news. This Holy Ghost power. Moreover, the Lord spake again unto Ahaz and said, ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God. Either ask it in the depth or in the height above. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he said, hear now, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and shall and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. He's talking to the same Ahaz. And he goes, look, you're going to get a sign. Now, this sign didn't come for hundreds of years. But nevertheless, this is it. A virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name God is with us. Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good. You know, this is, you talk about good news. We have 2,000 years of hindsight of the Christ. We have stories about people who changed the course of nations, people who needed things from God while they were running orphanages, running ministries of all kinds. And there are just testimony after testimony that God is faithful. This Holy Ghost power, God is faithful. With the temptation comes a way to escape. Shh. Take it. Live. If you will not believe, surely, this is God saying, surely you will not be established. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. Thou hast multiplied the nation and not increased the joy. They joy before thee according to the joy in harvest, and as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. We're talking about the time that the men that were at the time of the Christ being born. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. That's Gideon. When the angel came to Gideon and said, "Hail, O mighty man of valor," Gideon was hiding. He was threshing wheat behind a building, hiding so he could have some food to eat because the Philistines owned everything. And the angel comes and says, "Hail, O mighty man of valor." And he looked around. What? God calls us as he has made us to be. And you can, there is no power against it now. The Christ has come and walked right in and took away took over the keys of death and hell, took the dominion that the devil had. He took it away from him. And now you can have the Holy Ghost, this same Holy Ghost power that caused Jesus to overcome the devil, now dwells within us. You can break the generational curses. You can break every single thing. You can break when the people talk bad about you. The devices of the people are of no effect. It doesn't, you can do nothing against the truth, before the truth. There's all kinds of people. We got a president. We got his whole cabinet. They're full of evil and corruption. But they haven't done anything against the truth. Because you can't change truth. The fact is, the joy is still here. Do you want joy? The peace is still here. Do you want peace? Then humble your heart, because the end of the world is coming. It's not a time to hoard bullets and food, because governments are going to fall all over the earth. Jesus said, take no thought for your life. Like as Noah was moved by the fear of the Lord to build an ark because God told him, and it was accounted to him for righteousness, so our works are that we should take no thought for our life. We're not hoarding bullets. We're not hoarding food. God said, I got you. I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to walk you right into the next life. Hey, you're not going to break stride. You have the Holy Ghost. If you don't have that mentality, you don't have the Christ. You don't have the truth that came with the Christ. It's just like the Jews. They just took the Christ and said, we want a different Christ. Shove you off the hill. Well, we can't get him off the hill. Nail him on a cross. Are you going to love him at his appearing? Or are you going to be ashamed at his coming? I'm glad he didn't come a while back. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. From the day of Midian forward, man, Israel changed. It was a changed country. They got respect. And they went forward. And they prospered. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood. But this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Do you want to know why we're baptized in the name of Jesus? Because Jesus, when he said in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the Holy Ghost is the Mighty God. The name of the Everlasting Father is Everlasting Father. And the Son is the Christ, who we know was Jesus. So you're baptized in the name of the Christ, which is the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And that's Jesus. Of the increase of his government and peace. And peace. Hallelujah. There shall be no end upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it and to establish it with judgment and with justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. And he shall. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Oh, sorry, Lord. Okay, so here we are back up here. As in the day of Midian. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden, the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For the 400 years of them being in Egypt, and then the time of from there unto Gideon, and God broke the yoke off of Israel. And this is what he's saying: this child's coming and he's going to break the yoke. For thou hast broken the yoke of his burden as in the day of Midian. There's going to be a change in the earth when this child is born. The staff, the rod, the yoke is going to get broken as it was in Midian. And those are glorious. That Midian battle was a glorious thing. I mean, he took off and he took care of business. All the kingdoms around there. And the Lord just made a change in that country right there. Well, God made a change in the world right here with the Christ, as it was in the day of Midian. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. And I'm glad to tell you the good news that he did perform this. And there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. Okay, now look, the seven spirits of God over in the book of Revelation, right here, and it's on the Christ. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom, the Spirit of understanding, the Spirit of counsel, the Spirit of might, the Spirit of knowledge, and the Spirit of the fear of the Lord, the seven spirits of God, are going to be on him, on the Christ. And unto the angel of the church of Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. Remember, therefore, how thou hast received. We didn't receive when we were on the top of the mountain. We needed to fill the emptiness within us, or the destruction of our life, or the yearning of the soul to the Creator, and you humble your heart before your Creator, before your God, and you call His name, and you say, I want to be a new creature. Remember how thou hast received and how you began to hear His voice. It's not while you're being the trumpeter in God's ears. You're being the receiver from His mouth. And hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. And thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches, the capital S. If you do not watch, I will come on thee as a thief. What Jesus said to everybody here, what I say to thee, I say to all, watch. We're supposed to be looking and watching. We're not going to be dismayed by the signs of heaven. It's not a hand wringing, oh my goodness, oh, Jacob's trouble. Ooh. Look, I'm not Jacob no more. He formed me into Israel. Jacob's trouble is Jacob's trouble. It's not Mark's trouble. I pray for Jacob that they might be Israel, a Jew of the New Testament. Look, nothing can take your peace. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Jesus said, I'll tell you who to fear. Don't fear the guy that can just kill you. Fear him that after he kills you can put your body and soul in hell. Good counsel. Fear him. See? What's coming on them is not coming on me. I have the Christ. Now therefore, behold, the Lord bringeth up upon them the waters of the river, strong and many, even the king of Assyria, and all his glory. And he shall come up over all his channels, and go over all his banks, and he shall pass through Judah. He shall overflow and go over. He shall reach even unto the neck. Notice this is the neck, but not the head. That head of Judah, no man can reach. And the stretching out of his wings shall fill the breadth of the land, O Emmanuel. Here's some advice. Associate yourselves, O ye people, and ye shall be broken in pieces. Associate yourself with this king of Assyria. Associate yourself with him that fills the land. Associate yourself, and you shall be broken in pieces. And give ear, all ye of far countries, gird yourselves, and ye shall be broken in pieces. Gird your, in other words, he's trying to get everybody together, and they're all going to go down there, and they're all going to go to Judah, and they're all going to make war against Judah. This is coming. We're going to, probably, some of us are going to see it. They're going to live to see this. And he's saying, you're going to be broken pieces, and everybody that girds them together, take counsel together, and it shall come to naught. Speak the word, and it shall not stand, for God is with us. For the Lord spake thus to me with a strong hand, and instructed me that I should not walk in the way of this people, saying, say ye not a confederacy to all them to whom this people shall say a confederacy. Neither fear ye their fear. nor be afraid. This is the end times. This is what's going to take place. The whole world's going to get together whenever the beast stands up, and he's going to make war. And anybody that doesn't, he's going to, I'm coming after you. Hey, brother, bring it on. Look, we're in Christ. Where's your faith? This word is for us. Sanctify the Lord of hosts himself, and let him be your fear. And let him be your dread, and he shall be for a sanctuary. Now it goes back to the children of Israel. But for a stone of stumbling, for a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel. For a gin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And many among them shall stumble and be taken. Whoops. Stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken. Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. And I will wait upon the Lord that hideth his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs. This is Isaiah. If you read the name of if you read the name of Isaiah's children, they all had specific meanings. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts which dwelleth in Mount Zion. We have hindsight. We're looking back. We know all this. Well, not all this. We know that this came to pass whenever the Roman occupation came over Israel. We also know that the Savior came, but we also know that this has a meaning for that which shall come, because this was written for those upon whom the ends of the world have come, according to 1 Corinthians 10. This is for us. Behold, wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion. See, the Lord is going to dwell in Mount Zion. And nobody's going to try and get him out either. And when they shall say unto you, seek unto them that have familiar spirits and unto the wizards that peep and that mutter, should not a people seek after their God for the living to the dead? To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them, and they shall pass through it, hardly be stead and hungry. And it shall come to pass that when they shall be hungry, they shall fret themselves and curse their king and their God and look upward. And they shall look unto the earth and behold trouble and darkness, dimness of anguish, and they shall be driven to darkness. This is what's coming. How do you prepare yourself? You're not hoarding bullets and you're not hoarding food. You take no thought for your life. You get down on your knees in the morning and you take your cross. You get down and you humble your heart before your Lord. And you ask him, let me walk this day with you in righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. He watches over your generations to come. Don't take no thought saying. Don't let those words that are not faith come out of your mouth. I don't care what your issue. I don't care whatever is coming against you. Grace to you. Repent, be baptized in Jesus' name, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Corpus Christi, looks like there's going to be part two next week. Grace to you.
I love you so, and I'm never going to let you go. Holding on to your hand, though sometimes I don't.
My peace, and when I'm weak, he always stands by me. He gives me strength to carry on, even when all strength is gone. I can't explain the way I feel. All I know is that my God is real.